का बाइनोमियल थ्योरम, बाइनोमियल थ्योरम. वेरी इजी चैप्टर, वेरी वेरी स्कोरिंग चैप्टर, राइट? सो आई थिंक वी शुड बी एबल टू कवर दिस इन टू क्लासेस. आई जस्ट गिव यू एन ओवरव्यू ऑफ दिस चैप्टर. सो व्हाट आर वी गोइंग टू स्टडी अंडर दिस चैप्टर फॉर योर कॉम्पिटिटिव लेवल एग्जाम पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. इन स्कूल इट इज नॉट देयर, इट हैज बीन रिमूव्ड फ्रॉम योर स्कूल एग्जाम्स, राइट? सो we'll only be studying it from the competitive level exam point of view. So the first thing that we are going to talk about is the derivation of binomial theorem. So this is a theorem. How does it work? Okay. So what is the derivation of it? Okay. How come Pranav? We had one class on this in school, but it's not there in your CBSE syllabus. That's what Rajaji Nagar students told me. Ma'am said it is important. Okay. Then she is definitely a very concerned and sensitive teacher, because she knows that it is useful. Unlike many teachers who are not teaching at all. Guys, one thing I would like to bring to your notice. Board has never said that you should not teach it. Right? Board has said you should not test it. Okay? And she is very correct to say that it is very important. Okay, even when I, last batch, your senior batch, 12th batch, we never omitted anything from our syllabus, even though CBSE omitted a lot of things. And see, it paid off. Now the board's JEE main syllabus says nothing is omitted. Okay, but while many coaching institutes, they omitted the syllabus and they taught so that their effort is less. We could have also done it happily, but in the long run, it is going to harm you a lot. My second aim is you clearing an exam. My first aim is you understanding the concept, enjoying it, and knowing it very well. Exam is a byproduct. If you are studying from exam point of view, your knowledge will be very short-lived. It will be very ephemeral. Okay. Yeah. Sir, aap kitne mahan hai, sir. I'm not saying all this thing to show how great is Centum Academy, but yes. We definitely believe there is some non-negotiables, that understanding is the utmost priority for us. All right. So derivation of the binomial theorem. The next concept is the concept of the general term. Okay. Middle term terms. There can be more than one middle term. So middle term or terms. Okay. Then we'll talk about numerically greatest binomial coefficient, term and coefficient. They sound very similar, but they are not. We'll talk about it when the right time comes. Okay. Next is the application of binomial theorem. Some cases, divisibility problem, remainder problem, finding the last digit, second last digit, third last digit, etc. of a very heavy number. So those applications are there with us for us in this chapter. And finally, we are going to talk about binomial coefficient series. Binomial coefficient series. Okay. And lastly, a bit of multinomial theorem. What? Again, so we did this in PNC. Yes, you definitely did it in PNC, but we have to talk about it in more detail. Multinomial theorem. And finally, you have a bit of idea about 15 minute or 20 minutes idea on binomial theorem for non-whole number index. Okay. So these are the seven things that we are going to study in this chapter. Even though it looks like seven things, but I'm sure we'll be able to cover at least the first third in today's class only. Okay. And 4, 5, 6, 7 can be done in the next class. Okay. So are we ready to start ourselves with binomial theorem? Not a new concept. We have been using this in our, limits chapter when we were doing one of the standard limits called the standard algebraic limits. So not a new concept. So let's start. First of all, binomial theorem. It was discovered or invented, you should say, by Newton. One second, Akash. These are chapter's topic names. Something which are not important, like you can copy it after the session has commenced. Session is over. Okay. Pranav, which teacher is there for you in your school, HSR? Okay. All right, so binomial theorem. Before we derive this binomial theorem, there is certain observation. Let's do a certain observation. Okay, important observation. So I'll be introducing you to such terms where n is a whole number. Now, n can be a negative integer or a fraction also. That is something which we'll be taking in the end of the chapter. Remember, the last part of the chapter was binomial theorem for non-whole number index. So right now, we'll talk about the whole number index, which is basically 90% of your concepts in your binomial theorem. Last 10%, 5% concepts will be based on when the power is not a whole number. Now, why it is called a binomial theorem? Because it is applied to a binomial expression like this, right? Now, why normally it was called binomial? Because we consider that these two terms are dissimilar. So they're two dissimilar terms. Because they are two dissimilar terms, we use the word binomial. Okay. But that is like, you know, very, very, you can say rudimentary form of binomial theorem when it was, invented by Newton. We actually can apply it to similar terms also, right? We can also do 2 plus 3 whole square by use of binomial theorem. Doesn't make any difference to the approach. Okay. So don't be like too much into like, okay, they have to be dissimilar. Yes, when it was invented, when it was on the rudimentary phase, raw form, people use it for dissimilar terms. A and X are dissimilar terms. Now again, my aim is not to tell you that A is a constant and X is a variable. No. Think as if A is a first term, X is a second term, and they're dissimilar from each other, kind of. Right? But don't take it very, exact form. Don't think like there have to be dissimilar terms. They can also be applied to similar looking terms, as I already told you. Now, certain observations I would like you to have. And let me ask this as a question. What is a plus x to the power 0? Let's start with the lowest whole number, which is 0. What is a plus x to the power 0? 1. Okay, everybody is saying 1. What if I write 1 as 1 a to the power 0, x to the power 0. Any problem with that? We'll say, no, sir, this is 1 only. No problem. Okay, good. What is a plus x to the power 1? Guys, just have the good observation, because I'm writing it out for you to have a good observation on this. So we'll say a plus x. Correct? A plus x, absolutely, Gayatri. Can I write this as 1 a to the power 1, x to the power 0? And again, 1, a to the power 0, x to the power 1. Right? Pranav is trying to understand what is going on. Yes, absolutely, Pranav. Okay. Are, I should write this in yellow. It will look beautiful, no? Art, sir, for beauty and all, you erased it. Yeah. Let's have consistency. White and yellow. White and yellow. Okay. Next is a plus x whole square. What is it? You'll say, I mean, the formula that comes in your mind is a square 2ax plus x square, correct? What if I write it like this? 1a2x0, 2a1x1, and 1a0x2. Okay. Now, guys, don't worry about these numbers that you see. Worry about this a and x combination. How it is like written. Worry about that. Look a pattern in that. Numbers, I will talk about it in some time. Okay. Next. A plus x whole cube. These all formulas you have already done in your junior classes. So you say a cube, 3a square x, 3ax square, and x cube. right? What if I write it like this? 1a cube x naught, 3a square x to the power 1, 3a to the power 1 x square, and 1a0 x cube. Correct? Now, when you look at these terms only, the ones which I am showing from the right side with a bracketed under bracket, okay? What pattern do you see there? How are they listed down? Any pattern that you are able to observe here? No. They are not following Pascal's triangle. Pascal's triangle is followed by these numbers, which I'll talk about in some time, Gayatri. These numbers A and X, they are basically sharing that power or sharing this N among each other or between each other. Yes or no? Yes, absolutely, Namrata. So if you see, 0 is shared by these two. 1 is shared by these two. So 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay. So it starts with the entire power N being taken by A. And then what A does, it shares one power at a time with X. Sharing is caring, right? So A starts with, let's say A starts with the whole power. X starts with 0. Then what happens? A gives one power to X. And again, one more power. So like that, A starts giving one power to X. And slowly it becomes 0. And X takes the entire power. Okay. This is the pattern I would like you to observe over here as of now. Right? Now, I know most of you do not know the formula of A plus X to the power 4. Okay? But if you look, observe this pattern, at least we can write down these expressions. So let's say there is some number. I don't know which number. But I will have A to the power 4, X to the power 0. Again, some number, a to the power 3, x to the power 1. Okay. Then you have a to the power 2, x to the power 2. Then you have a to the power 1, x to the power 3. And then you have some number, a to the power 0, x to the power 4. Okay. So this observation actually helps us to write these terms at least. Okay. Now, what about these numbers, which I have not mentioned? What about these numbers? Now, these numbers come from an observation made by a French mathematician, Blaise Pascal, and he realized that it comes from a pattern like this. So this one that you see here, okay, write it like this. This one and this one, you write it like this. Okay, 1, 2, 1, write it like this. 1, 3, 3, 1, you write it like this. And he realized that when he was listing down these numbers, okay, the first number and the last number is always a 1. And the number in between comes from the addition of the top two. If you add these two, you'll get a 2. Similarly, if you add these two, you get a 3. You add these two, you get a 3 again. Okay. So with this pattern in his mind, he was able to construct the further rows. So the next row that will come is 1, 1, and here I'll get a 4, this will be 6, this will be 4 again, okay? And these numbers will fortunately become the coefficients of this question mark, or they will replace these question marks which I have put over here. So it would become 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. And this triangle that Blaise Pascal came up with was later on honored after his name, and it is called the Pascal's triangle. The Pascal's triangle. Okay. Not a new concept to you. We have already seen it when we were doing our permutation combination chapter. I gave you Pascal's identity. I gave you hockey stick identity. They were all based on this triangle itself. So thanks to this observation of pattern and thanks to this Pascal's triangle, that now we'll be able to write down A plus X to the power, any power we want. Of course, not a very heavy power right now because you have to make triangles to that extent. So I would request all of you, take a clue from this and just give me what is A plus X to the power of 6. Everybody please write this down. 30 seconds, 35 seconds, 40 seconds you may take. Yeah, I'll talk about binomial coefficient, everything, Himanshu, don't worry. And how they are similar and how they're different at the same time. Write down, Pranav. It doesn't take a lot of time. No need to type. Just say done. No need to type, please. Okay, Pranav is done. Good, Pranav. Just hold your answer. Vaibhav is also done. Done, 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 done. Okay, good. Yeah. So what I'm going to do is, first I will write down those AX combination. Something A6, X0. Something A5, X1. Something A4, X2. Something A3, X3. Something, let me write here, something A2, X4. Something A1, X5. And something A0, X6. Okay. So 6 came up as a power on A first, with X power being 0. And slowly, A started losing power one by one and X started gaining power one by one. Now, to know these bracketed terms, we have to take the help of Pascal's triangle. So, Pascal's triangle, this will be 1, 5, 10, 10, 5, 1. 1, 6, 15, 20, 15, 6, 1. Okay. So, this will become 1, 6, 15, 20, 15, 6, 1. Right? So you don't have to literally, you know, do A plus X to the power 6 by, you know, multiplying it to itself 6 times. Okay. So thanks to this theorem, thanks to this observation of pattern and this Pascal's triangle, that we are able to figure this out. So later on, Newton, he basically formalized it in the form of a theorem. So what theorem he brought up, and let us link the theorem that he found out with this particular approach. So I'm going to the next page. Permission is there, or anybody is copying? I'm sure most of you would have written this. Okay, can I go to the next page? Okay. So what is the theorem now? So Newton, what he did, A plus X to the power N, when N is in a whole number, it is what? It is basically A plus X into A plus X into A plus X. Like that, it will go N times, isn't it? Okay. Now read addition as OR and read multiplication as AND. Like the way we used to do it in permutation combination. So see, when you are trying to multiply it, okay, you're going to get several terms. Okay. Yes or no? So when you're going to expand it, you're going to get several terms. Right? Now, each of these terms that you see, let's say this is your term one, this is your term two, this is your term three. Now, I don't know how many of you know how many terms will come. Okay, so let's say this term number, I do not know. Okay, does anybody know till what terms, how many terms will I get from this? Anybody has an idea? N plus 1, N plus 2. Okay, many people are saying N. Okay, let's do one thing. Let's keep T question mark. Okay, some of you have studied it. They know it's N plus 1 terms. Okay, should I write it down? Okay, let me write it down. Okay, N plus 1 terms will come. Okay. You could also observe the pattern which I gave you just now. You can just see how is your exponent and number of terms related to each other.
I'm able to shoot.
Raghuram, your mic is on.
No.
Once again.
Damn it, guys. See, this is why I can't do 2v1s, man. I can't play this.
Okay, now Guram's mic is on, he is not aware of it. See, now what I'm trying to do is, everybody please pay attention here. Any term that you're formulating, whether it is T1, T2, T3, till Tn plus 1, every term is basically made up of either A or X coming from this factor, and either A or X coming from this factor, and either A or X coming from this factor. So read this like this, as if this is an army to be formed by picking up people from these households. So these are households, let's say house 1, house 2, house 3, correct, till house number n. Now let's say an army has to be formed, and this army will contain either A or X, not both. That means every household has to contribute one member, only one member, whether A or X, that is our call, and every household must contribute one. Right? So think, I normally give this example in every binomial session class. So think that there is a country which has got N households, okay? And every household has a man and a woman. So A is a man, X is a woman, okay? And the country all of a sudden has to go for a war, okay? So war has been called by the head of the country. So now as a responsibility of every citizen or every household, every household has to contribute one person, okay? Not both, because if both the people are going for the this thing, who will take care of the house, okay? So either A or X will participate from H1, either A or X will participate from H2, either A and H will participate from H3, and so on, right? And every household must contribute a particular person, right? Now let us say every household gives A. Then the army will be formed of all A's, so that will be A to the power N, right? That is the first term which we used to write, okay? You may also write it in a better way, A to the power N and no X, so X to the power 0 if you want to, okay? Let's say there's another way to make the army. So this is the first way to make the army. Another way to make the army would be, take A from N minus 1 households and 1 X from the remaining household. What did I say? Take A from N minus 1 households. Let me write it in white only to maintain the pattern. And take 1 X from the remaining household. But now, this one household who is contributing X, that itself can be chosen in NC1 way. So many people ask, sir, why are you choosing that house which is contributing X? Let's choose the house which is contributing A. So that can be chosen in NCN-1 way. Both of them are same, as we have learned in our permutation combination chapter. Correct? So it can happen that X can come from household number 1, and rest households will give you AAA. Right? Or it can happen that second household gives you X. Right? So the female member of the second household says, I will participate in the war. And the other household, H1, S3, etc., they give AAA like that. Now, in the same way, just keep thinking, how many ways can you make an army where two of the family contributes to X and the rest contributes to A? So that will be NC2 A to the power N minus 2 X squared. Right? If this trend continues, the last will be NCN A to the power 0 X to the power N. Means all women of the family have decided to go for a war. Okay, and I'm sure they will win it. Yes or no? In order to make it consistent, let's have NC0 over here, right? So this is what Newton figured out, right? So let me write it like this, okay? So these terms that we used to see in the Pascal's triangle were actually nothing but they were the NCR terms. Let me show you how. This one, I'll write on few of the, okay? This term 1 that you see, it is actually 0C0. This is 1C0. This is 1C1. This is 2C0. This is 2C1. This is 2C2. This is 3C0. This is 3C1. This is 3C2. This is 3C3. Okay. I think I already told this in your permutation combination chapter, but just to reiterate the same thing. Okay. So what Newton figured out was a theorem actually. So he said that A plus X, so what's the theorem? So the theorem is A plus X to the power N, N being a whole number. This theorem is working only for whole number. Okay. This can be written as summation of NCR A to the power N minus R X to the power R, R going from 0 to N. This is called the binomial theorem. Okay, or this formula can help you to expand any such binomial expression, Okay, again, I would like you to understand this fact. A here is the first term over here, and X here is the second term. Don't be like, be so rigid about its definition that it has to be A. A means some constant, or it has to be just X. No. I can also apply something like this. Let's say 5x squared plus 1 by 3x to the power of 10. I can apply binomial theorem on this. So this will behave like your A, and this will behave like your X. This is just written for you to, you know, keep this formula in mind. Don't be very, very rigid on its way, the way I've written it. A is your first term, X is your second term. Okay. One more thing I would like to highlight over here. If let's say there is an expression where there is a minus sign in between, okay, let's say this, then what do we do is we put a plus and we include the minus sign with the second term. Okay, so same theorem will be applicable, right? So don't be like, okay, if this is plus, some different theorem will be there, and if there's a minus, some different theorem will be there. No, theorem is the same. It's just that the minus sign is made a part of the second term. Okay, so let's do some simple exercise before you know, we talk about anything else. Any questions so far? So far looks easy. Any kasta? No kasta? Okay, let's move on. Some simple question we will take, and then I will complicate your life. Why, sir? Humne aapka kya bigada hai, sir? Hum nanhe munne bacche hai, sir. All dangerous problems I am seeing. Ayyo. Ah. Few easy ones. Okay, let's do one thing. Let's ignore the question. My question is just find the expansion of this term. Forget about the seventh term. Okay, as of now, ignore this. Just write the expansion of this term. Okay. Sir, 14 terms you have to write. Okay, let me reduce the power. Let me make this as 6. Right? I know 14 terms will be like slightly too much. And just say done. Okay, you don't have to even write them on your chat box. I will do it for you. Write down the expansion of 4x minus 1 by 2 root x whole to the power of 6. Since this is your first question, take some time, write it properly. Done? Okay. So first term would be, by the way, as I told you, include negative sign with the second term. Okay. So the first term will be 6c0, 4x to the power 6. No need to expand it. Please do not waste your time doing it. My purpose was just to show you the expansion in general. Okay. Next term will be 6c1, 4x to the power 5, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 1. Okay. Next will be 6c2, 4x to the power 4, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 2. Then will be 6c3, 4x to the power 3, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 3. Then 6c4, 4x to the power of 2, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 4. Then 6c5, 4x to the power of 1, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power 5. And then 6c6, 4x to the power of 0, minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 6. Okay. If you really expand it, you would realize one small observation that there will be alternative plus minus terms coming up. Okay, there will be alternative plus minus terms coming up because of this negative sign. So whenever there's an odd power on this term, a negative sign will feature in between. Okay, so the presence of an alternative, you know, plus minus terms in an expansion tells you that one of the terms or the sign in between has to be negative. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions? Okay. If this is clear to you, I have a question for you. Are you, sir? Second question only, this is difficult. Okay, I would like you to try this out. Okay, even if you're not able to do it, don't worry too much about it. Find the sum of this series. Now, this is linked to whatever we had learned a little while ago. Okay, that's why I thought I would give you these questions. So, summation of minus 1 to the power r ncr times 1 by 2r, 1 plus 3 to the power r by 2 to the power 2r, etc. Look at these terms very carefully. Okay, up to n terms. And this r is going from 0 to n. This r is going from 0 to n. Let's see how many of you are able to attempt this question. Take your time, 1 minute, 1.5 minutes. And even if you're not able to answer, don't worry. I know this is a difficult one to crack, given that we just started the chapter today. Yes, any success stories to share? Nobody, not yet. Difficult to crack? Okay. See guys, let me take this up. 30 seconds, you want more? Okay, Aditya, good. That's like a fighter. Yes, alternating sign. And these terms are also written in a very peculiar way. Right, Aditya. Okay, now see, if you just open up this term, let's say I open up this term like this, summation r equal to 0 to n minus 1 to the power r n c r, and let's take the first term, 1 by 2 to the power r. Okay. Next, again, summation r equal to 0 to n minus 1 to the power r n c r. This I can write it as, correct me if I'm wrong, 3 by 4 to the power r. Right? Because 2 to the power 2 r is like 4 to the power r. Right? Similarly, the third term would be summation r equal to 0 to n minus 1 to the power r n c r 7 by 8 to the power r. Correct? And this continues dot 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 for n term, m terms. So m terms are like this. Okay. Now, let us look into the first term, this term. Let's try to analyze this term a bit. If you write it down, let's say in expanded format, you would write nc0 half to the power 0. Okay. Then you'll write minus nc1 half to the power 2. Oh, sorry, half to the power 1. Correct. Then again, nc2 half to the power 2. And this will go with an alternating plus minus sign till ncn. Okay, minus 1 to the power ncn half to the power n. Okay. A clear analysis of this will tell you that, sir, you are writing actually 1 minus half to the power of n expansion. Isn't it? Am I not writing 1 minus, or you can treat it like 1 plus minus half, take it in brackets, whole to the power n expansion? Yes or no? Does this convince you, first of all? Gayatri is convinced. Others, convinced? How do you know it's not the other way? Other way as in? Oh, half minus 1. Half minus 1 to the power c. Okay. See, if it is half minus 1, of course, you would realize, see, doesn't make a difference because you're writing the same thing in a reverse way. But yes, it is very important. If you write half minus 1 to the power of n, the first term would have been nc0 half to the power n, right? Which may not have a negative sign. Right, this may not be the same term as this because it depends upon n actually. Right, the next term would be minus nc1 half to the power n minus 1, right, which may not be the term which is just second last term. So sign will get different over here, Aditya. Sign will differ. Are you getting my point? So till we are aware of that n, we cannot comment that it is same as, see, if n was even, it won't make a difference whether you write 1 minus half to the power n or n minus half to the power n. Pranav is spamming something on this group. What is this, Pranav? Half. What are you trying to say? I didn't get you. You're trying to say the answer. No. Answer is still to find out. Wait, don't worry. Answer is not that. Wait. So if this is understood, can I also say that I know the second term also? The second term is actually 1 minus 3 by 4 to the power n. Third term will be 1 minus 7 by 8 to the power n. And this continues till m terms. Yes or no? Since first term is, all of you are convinced that it is this, you should also be convinced that the second term is this, third term is this, and so on and so forth. Correct? Which means you are convinced that we are trying to sum up something of this sort. Correct? Till m terms. Okay. not to panic looking at it, because it is actually a geometric series. Okay, this is actually a geometric series whose first term is a 1 by 2 to the power n. Second term is the multiplication of the first with 1 by 2 to the power n. Third term is again you multiply 1 by 2 to the power n, and so on. So this is clearly a geometric series, with your first term being 1 by 2 to the power n, common ratio also 1 by 2 to the power n, and number of terms is m. Number of terms is m, right? So for such a series, we already know the formula, and the formula is what? What is the sum? First term, right? 1 minus the common ratio raised to the power total number of terms by 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power m. Okay, this is going to be your answer. If you want to, 1 second, 2 to the power n, not n. Yeah. If you want to simplify it, it is your call. Go ahead and simplify it. But my purpose was to just convey the idea to you. Does it make sense? Was it a difficult question actually? No. It was based on your basic understanding of the binomial theorem structure. Right, Pranav, did you get your answer now? Did you get your mistake also? Okay. Right? All right. Now we'll do some analysis on the binomial theorem that we have just now figured out. A small analysis. The first analysis is the number of terms. The number of terms in a binomial coefficient is n plus 1. But this is subject to the fact that the terms involved are dissimilar. Okay. Why I'm saying you this is because, let's say somebody says 2 plus 3 to the power of 2. You'll only get one answer, that is 25. Right? So according to this observation, it should have been 3, but the answer is only 1. Right? So this is when you are assuming that the terms involved are such that if you expand them, they don't get absorbed in each other, or some of the terms do not get combined and give you a single term. Okay. So number of terms is n plus 1 under the assumption that there is no combination of like terms happening. Okay. So this is the maximum number of terms that you can get. That is what you can actually say. Okay. Anyways. Now this is to be perceived as if you are trying to distribute. Please note that this is actually the number of ways to distribute two identical objects, or you can say n identical objects between two persons. Okay. If you recall this concept that we had done in our permutation combination chapter, so let's say you're trying to distribute n identical laddus to two people. Okay. Let's say Sita and Geeta. N laddus have to be distributed, and these laddus are all identical. How many ways can you do that? Remember, we had learned a formula, and the formula was n plus r minus 1 cr minus 1. Correct? N being the total number of objects which were identical, r being the total number of people among which we were distributing the objects. So it will be n plus 2 minus 1 c2 minus 1, which automatically comes to be n plus 1 c1, which automatically comes to be n plus 1. Now, why I'm telling you this formula is because you can scale this concept up to find out the total number of terms, even if you are given a trinomial, or to be more generic, even if you were given a multinomial, right? For example, let's say if somebody asks you, how many terms are there in a plus b plus c whole square? I know all of you know 6 terms are there, right? But let's say as a person who would like to solve this from PNC point of view, I would treat it as if I'm trying to distribute 2 laddus between 3 people, right? 2 identical laddus, right? Or pastries, Christmas time, cakes and pastries. Okay. 2 identical slices of cake is to be distributed between 3 people. How many ways can I do that? Your answer will be n plus r minus 1 cr minus 1. That's nothing but 4c2, 6 ways. That means there will be 6 terms in this expression. A square, B square, C square, 2AB, 2BC2CA. Okay, so again, this is subject to the fact that there is no absorption of term happening between, you know, several terms in that given expansion. Because if, let's say, I use this to find the expansion of this 1 x plus 1 by x plus 1, here you will realize you only have x square, 1 by x square, 1, then you'll have a 2, then you'll have a 2x, then you'll have a 2 by x. And now 1 and 2 can be combined to become a 3. Normally we combine the like terms, right? So there are only 5 terms here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this formula will fail. This formula will fail, right? So don't think that you have got a, you know, the all-encompassing formula to solve these kind of questions. The questions may be involving some like terms also. There this method will not work, or there this formula will fail, so as to say. Are you getting my point? So this is number one observation. Acha, let me ask you this question. I think I would have a question on that. Okay. The number of terms in the expansion of this are 36. Find n. Who will tell me this? Yes, anybody. Okay, Pranav, good. Very good, Aditya. Okay, so R is 3 here. N is not known to us. But you know for the fact that N plus R minus 1 CR minus 1 is 36. We very well know the formula of NCR, which is N plus 2 factorial by 2 factorial n factorial. This is 36. This is nothing but n plus 2 n plus 1 is equal to 72, right? 72 can be written as 9 into 8. So either you compare n plus 1 with an 8 or you compare n plus 2 with a 9, either ways you will get n value as 7 only. Answer is 7. Okay, so if you expand x plus y to the power 7, x plus y plus z to the power 7, and x, y, z are all such terms which are dissimilar to each other such that they don't combine on expansion, or they don't give like terms on expansion, then total number of terms here will be 36 terms. Then that would be a question in itself, Aditya. So these formulas will change. So there are different ways to deal with it. Don't worry. When such problems will come, we'll basically tackle it. Okay. So yes, of course, as you correctly stated, that there would be certain cases given to you where combination will happen. We'll talk about it when the problem comes. Okay. Don't worry about it. So now we'll continue with our analysis. So this was the first analysis. Second thing that I would like to discuss is the general term. General term basically helps you to figure out or find out a term with a certain power of the variable. Okay, for example, there was one of the question, remember in the first question, the question was find the coefficient of x to the power 7 in that expansion. And I said, okay, ignore that x to the power 7 and just do a general expansion. Those type of questions can be solved by this concept. So listen to this. The general term is basically the one which I wrote it in the binomial theorem expansion NCR a to the power n minus r x to the power r. This is actually your r plus 1th term. Remember this. This is not your rth term. Guys, let me tell you, because r starts from 0. So r is a number which starts from 0 to n. Let me write it like this. R is a whole number which belongs to 0 to n. So we cannot say this is not the rth term, because if you're saying this is the rth term, means you're trying to say 0th term. 0th term doesn't make sense. Your terms can only take natural numbers positions, right? First term, second term, third term, right? So this is an expression for the r plus 1th term. If you put r as 0, you automatically get the first term, which is nc0 a to the power n x to the power 0. If you put r as 1, you automatically get the second term, which is nc1 a to the power n minus 1 x to the power 1. Okay. Now many people ask me, sir, why you give this formula? Why can't you give me this formula? TR, where R is your natural number from 1 to n plus 1. See, I can give this formula to you also. But you will see that this formula is much more ugly to remember. It will look like this. NC R minus 1 A to the power N minus R plus 1 X to the power R minus 1. Which is the more easier formula to remember, tell me. Isn't it this, right? So if I want, I can give you this formula also, but you will not be able to remember this and a lot of mistakes will happen. And in fact, you have to write more actually, right? So better to write it like this rather than writing it like this. Okay. So I will erase it in case somebody gets confused and starts using it. Is this fine? Any question? The third thing that I would like to discuss is the middle terms. Middle term bracket S, because there can be either one middle term or more than one. Okay. Now, why there can be more than one middle terms? See, let me write some expansions for you. Let's say a plus x to the power of 2. Okay. If you expand it, you get this. To be more specific, nc0 a to the power 2 x to the power 0. 2c1 x to the power 1 a to the power 1, 2c2 x to the power a to the power 0 x to the power 2, correct? How many middle terms do you see here? You say only one. This guy is your middle term. Okay. So only one middle term is there. However, if I write a plus x cube, you will write 3c0 a cube x0, 3c1 a square x1, 3c2 a1 x square, 3c3 a0 x3. There are two middle terms over here. See, whenever there are even number of objects, there cannot be a single middle term. There has to be multiple middle terms, right? For example, if you have four fingers, I ask you, which is the middle finger, right? There's no middle finger here. There are two middle fingers. Okay, so these two will be middle fingers. Okay, two middle terms. But if there are three, then which is the middle finger? This one. Okay. Is it fine? Understood? Okay. Now, if you make a pattern out of it, tell me, first of all, whether there will be one middle term or multiple middle terms or two middle terms depends upon what? You say it depends upon n, correct? So let's try to devise a mechanism or a formalization of this concept. So if n is even, there will be one middle term because n plus 1 will be odd. Total number of terms will be odd. If total number of terms are odd, there can be only one middle term. Okay. So if n is even, then there will be only one middle term. But my question to all of you is, can you tell me what is the position and the expression of that middle term? Which term will be the middle term in this case? Think and answer. You can take multiple examples. You can take a plus x square. You can take a plus x to the power 4. You can take a plus x to the power 6. And give me a formula in terms of n as to which will be the, what will be the position and the expansion or the expression for that middle term. Very good, Pranav. Anybody else? Very good, Hariharan. So yes, people are giving me absolutely correct response. It will be n by 2 plus 1th term. That will be your middle term. Okay. Anybody who wants to contest this? Are you all convinced? You can check it out. You can see for yourself. Do a bit of verification. And that expression will be nc n by 2 a to the power n by 2 x to the power n by 2. Got the point? And just to remind you, this will be the greatest binomial coefficient of all the terms. This will have the greatest binomial coefficient. Guys, I'm not trying to say greatest coefficient. I will talk about it very soon in today's class only. This will have the greatest binomial coefficient. NCN by 2 is the greatest binomial coefficient. Okay, so the middle term or terms will always have the greatest binomial coefficient. Okay. Anyways, coming to the fact when n is odd. When n is odd, we already discussed that total number of terms would be even. If total number of terms will be even, there will be two middle terms. There will be two middle terms. Can somebody tell me what will be the position of those two middle terms and hence what is their expression? Take example, you can start with a plus x to the power 1. You can take a plus x to the power 3. You can take a plus x to the power 5. So take some, easy to manage cases with lighter powers. N by 2 plus n plus half. That is 3n by 2 plus half. Gayatri didn't quite get that. Okay. N by 2 plus 1.5. That's a good way to state it. Okay. So the position of your middle terms would be n plus 1 by 2 and n plus 3 by 2. First, convince yourself. Take some examples. Okay, let's take a plus x to the power 5, right? I will not write it, but I know for sure that there are six terms into this. So t1, t2, t3, t4, t5, t6, okay? These are the two middle terms. Now 3 comes from 5 plus 1 by 2 and 4 comes from 5 plus 3 by 2. So these expressions are absolutely correct, okay? Now when you have to expand it, remember, we had learned an expression for r plus 1th term. So you have to write it in the same way. You have to write it in a slightly lengthy fashion like this so that you know this is your r. So now you can say ncr a to the power of n minus r, which happens to be n plus 1 by 2, x to the power r, which happens to be this. Okay. This term can be written as tn plus 1 by 2 plus 1. So this will become ncn plus 1 by 2 a to the power n minus 1 by 2 x to the power n plus 1 by 2. Okay. So these will be the two middle terms. And also needless to say that these two will be the greatest binomial coefficient and they would be equal. They would be the greatest binomial coefficient and they would be equal. Yes, Hariharan, do you have any questions? Do you have any question to ask? Can you scroll up? Okay. How much up? This much up? Top right. Yeah, top right. Clear? Any questions? Okay. Now we're ready to take up some questions. Let's start solving few questions. Let me know if everybody is done copying with this. Done. Okay. Let's have this question. Yeah, this question which we had distorted, let's now solve this question. Find the seventh term in this expansion. Of course, you will not sit and write all the 14 terms. Can we find an easier and a convenient way to directly write down the seventh term? If yes, please do so and just type done on your chat box so that I can discuss it. Write down the seventh term of this binomial expansion. Yes, done. Let's discuss it, guys. This is very simple. If you want the seventh term, you have to write it like this, 6 plus 1, because then this will tell you what is the R to be used for that. So it will be N C R, first term to the power of N minus R, second term. Remember, second term will have minus inclusive. Okay. So this will give you 13 C6. 4x to the power 7, and this you can write it as by 2 to the power 6, x to the power 3. So I will not do a lot of simplification, but yes, I will do certain simplification which will make our life easy. (2^8, x^4). Okay, no need to expand it further because you would need a calculator for it, which is not allowed anyways. Is it fine? So thanks to the general term that we are able to write such expansions without having to go to that term. Okay. The same question. If I ask you, find the seventh term from the end. Okay. Let's take a second part of the question. Find the seventh term from the end. From the end in the expansion of whatever was the expansion, I think 4x minus 1 by 2 root x to the power of 13. Now, I know you can do it, but the safest and the fastest way to do this problem is people start counting from backwards, which is time consuming. Just reverse the position of these two terms. And instead of finding seven term from the end, find the seven term from the beginning. That will be your answer of the seven term from the end. So if you reverse the position of these two terms, then the seventh term from end in this will be the seventh term from beginning in this. Okay. And this is much easier to deal. So we can directly write it as t^6 + 1 in this, so it'll be 13 C^6 - 1 by to the power 7, 4x^6. Okay, is it fine? Okay, you can simplify this and get your job done. So if some question says find the seventh term or find some nth term from the end, reverse the given binomial term positions and then write down the same position from the beginning. Okay, you don't have to reverse count it. Is it fine? Any questions? Let's take another one. Let's take this question. Find the coefficient of x^8 in this expansion. Done. Okay, now see, in this type of question, obviously you will not sit and write all the terms and try to consolidate the powers and see which power is giving you power of 8. Okay, so there has to be a shorter and faster way to do these kind of questions. Correct? So here, what do we do is, we say, let tr plus 1th term contain x to the power 8. Okay. So, see, it is impossible for us to write 11 terms and then consolidate the powers of x and check which one is finally giving you x to the power 8. That would be too time consuming. Okay. So in order to do this question, we have to first assume that let r plus 1th term contain x to the power 8. So r plus 1th term would be what? R plus 1th term will be 10cr x square to the power of 10 minus r and minus 1 by x to the power r. Okay. So let's say this contains x to the power 8 term. Correct? If you take all the constants together, and all the powers of x together, this is what we see. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. Now, if this contains x to the power 8 term, that means it clearly implies that this power over here is actually an 8. That means 3r is 12. So r is equal to 4. Correct. That means your 5th term contains x to the power 8, and that term itself would be 10c4 minus 1 to the power 4, okay, x to the power 8. So this will be called as the coefficient. Guys, again, get this clear. All the constants combined together with the variable, all the constants which is present with the variable, that is called the coefficient of that variable. So this whole thing, that is 10c4, that is going to be your answer. By the way, 10c4, I think is 210. I have to just check it out by 24. Yeah, 210. So the answer is 210. Is this fine? Why 3? Why 3r, Hariharan? See, Hariharan, we have 20 minus 2r already, and this x will also have a power of r, right? Exponent rule, exponent laws. See, I think I have to write it in a much more easier way. See, this term, 10cr x to the power 2 into 10 into r is what? 20 minus 2r. This is minus 1 to the power r by x to the power r. So if you consolidate this to single power of x, what will you write? Okay, and minus 1 to the power r will be clubbed with the constant. This is what I wrote in a direct way. Got it, Vaibhav? Hariharan? Okay. Now, one small thing I would like to add to this, since we are doing these kind of problems. Let's say hypothetically, if you solve for r and r did not come out to be a positive integer, that means r came out to be negative integer or a fraction. So please note this. If r does not belong to a whole number, then the coefficient of such a term should be written as 0. That means such a term was actually not present only in the expansion. So if something is not present in the expansion, we have to write its coefficient as 0. Right? So it may happen that you're solving a question and you try to get an r and you got, let's say, 5 by 2. Or you get r as minus 3. Hypothetically say. Then basically such a term is not there in your expansion. Okay. And if it is not there in the expansion, you can always write its coefficient as 0. Is that fine? Any questions, any concerns? All right. We'll take more questions. Don't worry. Okay, let's take this term. If the coefficient of three consecutive terms in the expansion of 1 plus x to the power n is 165, 330 and 462 respectively, find the value of n. Find the value of n. Coefficient of three consecutive terms. I'm not saying coefficient of first three terms. Three consecutive terms. Very good, Pranav. Anybody else? Guys, do not leave the meeting. I'm taking attendance right now. Some of you have become very quiet, like Pratik. Pratik, how are you? How are you doing nowadays? And there used to be a gentleman by the name of Shashwat. He's not there in the class also. Who else? Rehan, Rishabh, Swaraj Singh. Present, sir. Yes. Two people have answered so far. Others? Come on, guys. Keep participating. Looks lively. Have you seen a cricket match? What is the role of a wicketkeeper? His role is not only to keep the wickets. Sledging, huh? Yes, of course, he sledges the opposite team, but also keeps on encouraging the team members. Isn't it? Chalo, come on, milega, is ball pe milega, like that he says, isn't it? I remember they keep saying, oh, this is a weak batsman, he'll come and go, one ball only, he'll come and go. Rishabh Pant, I have not seen him play, to be very, very sorry about that. Modern day cricket, I'm so much alienated from the modern day cricket because it's happening too much. IPL and all those. We used to wait for those series to happen, India versus Australia or India versus Pakistan or the Saja Cup. We used to wait for 3 months, 4 months. Now cricket is like overloaded. Ah, some West Indies. See, to be very frank, I don't even know the entire team that plays for India. I know a few of them. Virat Kohli. I think I know only one person. Shikhar Dhawan sometimes. I hear his name. Not in 80s also. 80s was like beyond me. I was like, I belong to Tendulkar, Dravid, Saurav Ganguly's era. Yeah, Charan, you're absolutely correct. It's now a commodity. It's no more a game. It's commodity. Yes, you can say it was an entertainment. It is always an entertainment. But now it is more of a commodity. Yeah. All for commercials, yes. Some big scam will surface out after IPL and all. Same with me, Shreyas. The first IPL I saw in 2008, and after that, I never wasted my time. Because I thought it's like one of the, you know, occasions they have conducted such a, you know, gala event where all the states are participating. After that, it is every year. Who will waste time sitting in the front of TV watching 2-2 matches back to back? We are not that jobless also, please. Chala guys, let's discuss this. See, here, your coefficients will actually be the binomial coefficients, right? So can I say, let's say, the coefficient of the rth term, which is NCR minus 1, is 165. Okay. Coefficient of R plus 1th term is 330. And coefficient of R plus 2th term is 462. Okay. Now, the only way to figure out what are the values of N and R is the use of one of the properties which I had discussed in the permutation combination chapter, which was this property. Okay. NCR by NCR minus 1 is N minus R plus 1 by R. Okay. So if I use it on this two, first of all, let's say, so 330 upon 165 is going to be N minus R plus 1 by R. By the way, this is 2. So 2R is equal to N, or you can say 3R is equal to N plus 1. Okay. 3R is equal to N plus 1. This is the first formula that we get. Okay, Charan, we'll check. The next is, if you replace your R with an R plus 1, then NCR plus 1 by NCR, that will be 462 upon 330. Okay. If I'm not mistaken, this is divisible by 11. Yes or no? 11. Yes, 11. So it'll be 42 times 11, and this will be 30 times 11. And of course, it can go by 6 as well. So 66 to be more frank. So this will be 5, and this will be 7, 7 by 5. But NCR plus 1 by NCR is just replacement of R with R plus 1. That's it. Okay. So 7R plus 7. If you open this bracket over here, it will give you 5n minus 5r. Correct me if I'm wrong. Right? So 12r is equal to 5n minus 7. So clearly I can say 5n minus 7 is 4 times n plus 1. That means n is equal to 11. That's your answer. Let me write it over here, from 1 into. Is it fine? I mean, this was a question which was already done a multiple number of times while we were doing PNC chapter, just a repetition of the same. Okay. I will take up more questions, but right now I think most of you need a break. Okay. We started at 3:45. So it's almost like, you know, 2 hours, 20 minutes kind of a thing. So let's have a small break. Yeah, we definitely need a break. So the next concept, in fact, the next problem that we are going to take is a slight complex question based on the similar concept. Oh, I think we have not done any question on middle terms. I'm so sorry about it. Let's take some middle terms question. Let's take this question. Find the middle term. In fact, they should write middle terms if at all there can be more than one. So find the middle term or terms in the expansion of 3x minus x cubed by 6 to the power 9. So if n is odd, we have already decided, discussed that there will be two middle terms. Correct? So there will be two middle terms. So what are those middle terms? Let's figure it out. Just write done once you're done. No need to simplify it. Just say done so that we can discuss it. Okay, Pranav. No issues. Okay. So n is an odd number, 9, which is basically your n. Okay, this is your n. If this is odd, there are two middle terms. And what are those middle terms? Tn plus 1 by 2th and Tn plus 3 by 2th. By the way, they are just one difference apart. So if this is fifth, then this will be sixth. Okay. So for T5, we have to use R value as 4. So it will be 9C4, 3x to the power of 5, and minus x cubed by 6 to the power of 4. Okay. No need to waste time in the simplification process because this is a simple question to solve. And for 6, I have to keep my R as 5. So 9C5, 3x to the power of 4, and minus x cubed by 6 to the power of 5. Okay, so these will be your two middle terms. Any questions? Easy? Okay. So we'll start complicating it slightly. Okay, next question from for you is, which is more? Hundred and one to the power 50 or 100 to the power 50 plus 99 to the power 50. Which is more? Okay. Now, of course, you have to justify your answer, whatever you're trying to reasoning you're trying to draw from it. So please justify your answer. Which of them is more? And please justify it. Why? Any idea, anybody? Okay, 101 to the power 50. Can I write it as 100 plus 1 to the power 50? Okay. Can I say it is 100 to the power 50 plus 50 C1, 100 to the power 49 plus 50 C2, 100 to the power 48 till 50 C50? Okay. Now, 99 to the power 50, in a similar way, can I write it as 100 minus 1 to the power 50? Now, since there's a negative sign over here, when you expand it, you will get alternating plus minus signs. Okay, as you can see here on your screen. Okay, but this will also end in 50C50. Right? Now, subtract these two. Subtract these two. Okay, Pranav. Okay. Subtract these two. When you subtract these two, on the right side, if you check, you will end up getting the second term twice up, fourth term twice up like that. So you'll get two times 50C1, 100 to the power 49. 50C3, 100 to the power 47, and so on. And the last term, I mean, I don't care about the last term, by the way, I don't need it. Okay. Now try to pay attention over here. 50C1 is like 50. 50C1 is 50. Correct. Yes or no? 50 into 2 will be 100. And there's already 100 to the power 49. And other terms will be twice 50C3. I will not waste time writing it. I'll just write dot, dot, dot. Okay. Now pay attention. Everybody please pay attention. This is 100 to the power of 50. And this is a positive term. Isn't it? This all term over here, which I'm not writing, it's actually a positive term. Right? I don't think so. There's a negativity in that term in what form, whatso form ever, right? So what do you figure out from here? We figure out that 101 to the power 50 minus 99 to the power 50 minus 100 to the power 50 is a positive term. Oh, sorry, I should have kept this symbol. Okay. Yes or no? And if this is a positive term, that means 101 to the power 50 minus 99 to the power 50 minus 100 to the power 50 is greater than 0. Because it's a positive term. Correct? So if this is a positive term, this is greater than 0. And if this is greater than 0, it automatically implies that 101 to the power 50 is greater than 100 to the power 50 plus 99 to the power 50. Okay, so this guy alone is bigger than the sum of the other two. So this is the winner. This is the term which is greater than the sum of these two. Is it fine? This is a very famous type of question. Normally it comes in competitive exam also, but it's there in Adi Sharma also. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns, please do ask. Okay, can I move on to the next question? Yes. All right. Let's take some more questions. Find the term independent of x in this expansion. Okay, what is the meaning of independent of x? Independent of x means it's a constant term, Gayatri. That means there is no x term related in that. That is the constant term. For example, if I say which term is independent of x in this expansion. So when you expand it, okay, this term is independent of x. I'm just giving an example here. This term is independent of x. Independent of x means no x in the term. Right. Pranav, when they say find the term independent of x, they do not mean the position, of course, only. They mean the value of the term also. This is a misinterpreted term by many students. When they see this, find the term independent, they mention the position. No, they're asking you the value of the term or the expression of the term. Very good, Pranav. Nice. Aditya has a different answer to give. Okay, Aditya. I'm not saying right or wrong to anybody. Okay. All right. Okay. Let's check. See here, when you are trying to find out the term independent of X, of course, you're not going to write all the 10 terms to see which term is independent of X, right? It's like not a feasible way to solve the question in that way. So we'll say, okay, let TR plus 1th term be independent of X. Be independent of X. Now we all know TR plus 1th term expansion is what? N C R this term to the power of N minus R this term to the power of R. Okay, now consolidate all the constants together. So what are the constants present over here? 3 by 2 to the power N minus R will be present, minus 1 by 3 to the power R will be present, and consolidate all X terms together. Now X terms will have a power of 18 minus 2R minus R, which is 18 minus 3R. Getting the point. Now you are claiming that this term, this guy is independent of X. Okay. If this guy is independent of X, it means 18 minus 3R should have been 0. Because then only your X will vanish off, isn't it? That means R has to be 6. Right? If R is 6, means 7th term is independent of X. Okay. And that term will be 9C6, 3 by 2 to the power of 3 minus 1 by 3 to the power of 6. Okay, let's simplify this. 9C6, this will give you, if I'm not mistaken, 1 by 8, and we'll have 3 to the power 3. Right? Yes or no? 9C6 is how much? 9 into 8 into 7 by 6. Okay, and 1 by 8 into 9 and 9 will go off, 8 and 8 will go off, so it's 7 by 18. So the term independent of X over here is 7 by 18. I will give you a live demonstration of this. I will use my GeoGebra tool. Sir, GeoGebra can be used here also. Yes, why not? Ayyo, yeah. So let's name this function as g of x. Somebody will take the cusp of telling me the term 3 by 2 x square. 3 by 2. There you go. 3 by 2 x square minus This is what I don't like. Minus 1 upon 3x. Ayo. Whole to the power of. What was the power, guys? I want to go back. 9. Oh, power only. Expand g of x. Okay. As you can see. Ooh. Okay. Now, since there is a 9 power on the top, a 9 power in the denominator, they have actually taken the LCM, I believe. You'll see this term will give you a, this term will give you a term independent of x, right? So try doing 3919104 upon 1007796. This will give you, as per our calculation, it should come out to be 7/18. Okay. I can quickly check on my phone whether it does it give it like that. So 3919104 upon 1007796. Okay, this gives you 0.388 into 18 gives you 7. Yes, this is 7/18. Okay, clear? Any questions? Okay, let's move on. To the next question. Okay. Find the sum of all rational terms in this expansion. Find the sum of all rational terms in this expansion. Excellent, Pranav. Very good. Pranav has cracked this. Well done. Anybody else who would like to contribute? Correct, Aditya. No, Hariharan, that's not correct. Anybody else? Okay, let's try to look into this problem. See, if you write down any r plus 1th term, you will be writing 15cr. 3 to the power 1/5 of 15 minus r and 2 to the power 1/3 of r, isn't it? Correct? Now, if you want this term to be a rational term, That means the powers on 3 should be integers, isn't it? So 15 minus r by 5 should be an integer, okay? And so should be 1 by 3 r. This should also be an integer, right? So these two should be integers, right? So what values of r will make both of them integers? Those will be the r values permissible for which I will get an r, for which I will get the tr plus 1 term as a rational quantity. Is this point clear, first of all? Then only it makes sense to proceed further. So does this make sense? Unless until these powers are rational integers, I will not get a rational quantity out of it. Because if any one of them happens to be a non-integer, okay. Now many times you will ask me, sir, what if 3 has a non-integral power and 2 has a non-integral power, but it combines to give you such a power for which we get a integer? It cannot happen. Because 3 and 2 are prime numbers. They do not share anything in common. Are you getting my point? Okay. So now, what is r here? R has to be a number from 0 to 15. Right? So let us check for which r from 0 to 15, both will be integers. Let us start with this first, because this looks simpler to me. So this says if r by 3 has to be an integer and r has to be 0 to 15, r can only take multiples of 3. Correct? 0, 3, 6, 9, 12, and 15. Right? Out of these, which will make even these as integers? Let us check that also, because both of them should be happy. It's not about one of them being happy. Both of them should be happy. So if you put a 0, yes, 0 works for this. Okay, so 0 is qualified. If you put a 3, you get 12 by 5. 12 by 5 is not an integer, so 3 is rejected. Okay, even though it is making r by 3 as an integer, it is failing to make r 15 minus r by 5 as an integer. 6? No, 6 will also fail. 9? 9 will also fail. 12? 12 will also fail. 15? Yes, 15 will work. Okay, so the final values of r that is going to give you a rational term is r equal to 0 and r equal to 15. Now, r equal to 0 is basically your first term. And r equal to 15 is your last term. So only the first and the last terms were rational. Rest all the terms were irrational. So all 16, out of 16, 14 of them were irrational. And only 2 of them, that is the first and the last, they were rational. So let's check what the first term. So first term would be 15c0. 3 to the power 1/5 of 15 minus 0 into 2 to the power 0. I think that gives you 3 to the power 3, 27, okay. And for 15, I'll get 15c15, 3 to the power 0, 2 to the power 5. That gives me 32 into 1. So the sum will be 27 plus 32. Answer is 59. Only two of you could get it, Aditya and Pranav. Well done, guys. No Charan, that's unfortunately not correct, but well tried. Happy to see everybody trying. Got Taitu. Yes, got it. Okay, let's take more questions. These all are. Find the term independent of x in the product of 4 plus x plus 7 x squared times x minus 3 by x to the power of 11. Okay, so in this product, okay, what will be the term which will not have x in it? That is, what will be the constant term that will come from the product of this? Your options are there in front of you. So I'll simply run a poll for you guys. Let's have 2.5 minutes for this. Very good. Three of you have responded so far. Last 30 seconds I can give you. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. 9 of you have voted so far. What happened to the others? Is it so difficult? Okay, let's check. Out of 9 of you who voted, 5 of you have said option B. Okay, so B and C had close calls. Hey, see, which terms will give you constants, right? So if this 4 multiplies with a constant over here, correct? So I need a constant in this. This x multiplies with some term containing 1 by x over here. And this 7x square multiplies with some term containing 1 by x square over here. Okay, so what am I looking for? I'm looking for constants from here. Okay. I'm looking for a term containing 1 by x. Correct. And I'm looking for a term containing 1 by x square. Because only these terms, when multiplied to 4x and 7x square respectively, can generate a constant. Right. So I will not solve this as 3 independent questions. I will say let r plus 1 a term be the one which individually satisfies these criteria. So I will take first the generic version. So r plus 1 term of this guy will be what? 11 cr x to the power of 11 minus r minus 3 by x to the power r. Right? So that gives you 11 cr minus 3 to the power r x to the power 11 minus 2r. Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct. Now, if you want this term to be a constant, if you want this term to be a constant, for constant, 11 minus 2r should be 0, which is not possible. Why not possible? Because r is going to give you 11 by 2. R cannot be a negative integer. R cannot be a fraction. R has to be a whole number. Right? So there will be no constant term in the expansion of x minus 3 by x to the power 11. Okay. For term containing 1 by x, you just have to equate this to minus 1. That means 2r is equal to 12. So r is equal to 6. Now this is possible. Okay. And the term would be the seventh term of that expansion, okay, which will be 11c6 Yeah. 11c6, and this will be minus 3 to the power 6. Okay. X to the power automatically minus 1 will come. You don't have to put the values. Okay. So this will be your term over here. So I would write it down over here. It's 11c6 into 3 to the power 6. Okay. Similarly, 1 by x square, this guy has to be minus 2. Again, this is not possible. Okay. So the only term which is constant will be when your 1 multiplies with this. So your answer will be 11c6 into 3 to the power 6. This is going to be your answer. Is it there in the option? Yes, option B is correct. Option B is correct. So Janta was correct. Most of you said B. However, by one more vote. Is it fine? Any questions here? Any questions, any concerns? Please note, the constant term was not obtained and the power of 1 by x, the power of x to the power minus 2 was not obtained. Right? Because our values corresponding to that was coming out to be non-whole numbers. Non-whole numbers have to be rejected. Or you can say coefficient will be 0 for those cases. Is that okay? Any question, any concerns, please do let me know. Done? Okay. Next question. Yeah. So if p to the power 4 plus q cube is 2, p is positive, q is positive, find the maximum value of the term independent of x in this expansion. Yes, any idea how to do this question? I think this word maximum is creating a lot of issues, right? Okay. But don't worry, there are some hints also given to you in the question. Hints. Let's see who is able to exploit that or use that. I'm launching the poll now. In case you're done with it, you can press on the poll. Good, good, good. Okay, at the count of five, we can stop the poll. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Please vote, please vote. Okay, most of you have voted for B, that is 14C6. Let's check. See, first of all, the process is very similar. Let tr plus one at term be independent of x. Okay. Be independent of x. Okay. And tr plus one at term here would be nothing but 14 cr p x to the power 1/12 to the power of 14 minus r. Okay. 14 minus r. And q x to the power of minus 1 by 9 to the power of r. Okay. So if you want it to be independent of x, the consolidated power on, let's write it like this. Yeah. And consolidated power on x will be 14 minus r by 12 minus r by 9. Correct? And this guy must be zero. This guy must be zero. Correct? Then only I'll get a term independent of x. That means 14 minus r by 12 should be equal to r by 9. Okay? So let's simplify this. 42 minus 3r is equal to 4r. R comes out to be 6. Correct? R comes out to be 6. So this term will be 14c6 p to the power 8 q to the power 6. Correct? Now the problem is, I have to find the max value of this subject to the fact that p4x q cube is 2 and p and q are positive terms. Guys, this is a big indication to you that you have to use AMGM inequality. You have to use AMGM inequality. Getting the point. So can I say if p and q both are positive, so will be p to the power 4 and q to the power 3. Correct? So can I say p to the power 4 plus q to the power 3 by 2 would be greater than equal to p to the power 4 q to the power 3 under root? Correct? Yes or no? That means 2 by 2 is greater than equal to p to the power 4 q to the power 3. That means p to the power 4 q to the power 3 is less than equal to 1, and so is p to the power 8 q to the power 6. That means max value of this fellow is going to be 1. So max value of this is going to be 1. That means max value of this entire thing is going to be 14c6. Answer is option number B. Janta is absolutely correct. Now, people who solved it, I'm sure you are not aware of this fact that you can use AMGM inequality. Is it fine, Pranav? Do you want to copy from here, this page? Then, question. Do let me know once you're done. Got it? Okay. Next concept that we are going to talk about